This is YOCF Summer Episode 5.
Clack, clack.
What am I supposed to say?
Clack.
Hey
What's up, guys?
Hi.
Welcome back to YOCF Summer episode
five. 10, but five.
Well, this episode is going to be a 10 out of 10. That's
yes,
why
it will.
I did
it. That's true.
This has been good. I feel like we've got a good groove going. We've done this a few times now.
Yes.
We know what to expect. Normally, we start with like a fun game, but nope. We're going to switch it up. We're going to do some quick announcements first. And you know, like, whenever somebody asks me, like, Ryan, do you want the good news or the bad news first?
Yeah.
I always say the bad news first. So we're going to start with some bad news. And the bad news is Popcorn Hannah.
Okay, well, thank you. Not to be the bearer of bad news, but Ryan made me.
Wow, well.
Unfortunately, we will not be having camp this summer.
Boo!
Yeah. I feel that too.
Boo! I'm screaming into the microphone so they can hear. Boo! Hannah.
I know.
That's awful.
I know.
Why would you say
it's
something
really
like
sad.
That?
Because it's what we've decided is going to be best for us to do.
Well, we decided?
We did decide.
Right, yeah,
this is not just my choice. Believe us, both Ryan and I love camp so much.
If I could live there, I would.
He has lived there.
I did. Yeah.
We announced this last time in our Zoom after meeting. Mm-hmm. And so if you weren't on there for that or if you weren't able to make it last time, we just want you guys to know that that's our update. And our final update is that we will not be having any sort of camp for the summer.
But once we're back, we will celebrate when we can do something, and it will be great. It might not be Hume, but it will be so good to be together.
Being together is enough, I think.
It would be enough for me.
Yeah, it would be
enough. It definitely would be. But speaking of our after Zooms, which you mentioned, after our episode, stick around because we will be doing our life groups and our small groups. We'll put a link in the chat box, so make sure you guys stick around. And that's honestly, that's my favorite part of these nights.
Yeah, so much fun.
Yeah, it's really good to see your guys' face.
Yeah.
In real life through a screen.
Real life through the screen.
Right, but make sure you stick around. We want to be praying for you guys. Mm-hmm. We want to hear what you guys are doing and how it's going. So.
Yeah. And another way that you can continue to stay connected with us and also other people inside your groups is us doing quarantine quiet time.
Quarantine quiet time.
We were doing that in the beginning of COVID happening, and so now we are continuing it on. So make sure that you get on the YouVersion Bible app and add YOCF, and we will hook you up into the plan that we're doing, and you can comment back to each other of how it's going, what you're learning, and being able to follow along with what we all are getting to do in the mornings.
In addition to that, another good way you guys can stay connected is we are putting out weekly YOCF in the Wild videos. You can find those on our YouTube page, but it's just a little devotion, a long devotion or a sermonette, and we're currently talking through the fruit of the Spirit. So one of us, I think, Hannah?
I think I'm doing it this week.
Actually, this week is next week. One of us will be doing
it. One of us will have one.
And it's a good time. So make sure you guys are doing that. And we encourage you guys to do those with friends.
Yeah.
So grab some people. Maybe it's your small group. Maybe it's your leader. Maybe it's some friends in the youth group. Maybe it's some friends out of the youth group.
True.
Doesn't matter. Grab those people and do that study together. It'd be a good time.
Yeah. And just like Ryan said, doing it in community is great. And if you are a part of a small group or in a life group, make sure that you're contacting your leader for the off weeks that we're not doing this. On those weeks, see if your leaders are still meeting. See if your group is still meeting. That's a perfect opportunity for you guys to be doing YOCF in the Wild or just getting together and having more fellowship time. But if you don't know who is your leader or what group to go to, just message Ryan or I, and we can get you connected to your leader in your group.
Another good way to stay connected is to be following us on Instagram, at YoYoYoCF. Hannah and I, we're figuring out what the fall is going to look like. Mm-hmm. So we said we're going to do 6 summer episodes. So this is number 5. After number 6, we don't know yet. So if you want to be the first people in the know about what it's going to look like this fall, follow us on Instagram. We'll post, you know, like in our stories or in a post, kind of like the plan, and we'll announce things here on these episodes too. But Hannah, I have a game for us.
Okay.
We've played this one already, so you'll know how to play. We're we're gonna take a look at two different TikTok videos. TikTok, if you don't know, because I'm super hip and in the know, is this social media platform.
Hey.
It's like YouTube, but super short.
Ooh.
It's like Vine, but super long.
What's Vine?
It's you are the, he's the vine, and oh. He is the branches.
Not like vineyard vines.
Not like that.
Oh.
No.
Okay.
I wonder if there are any students who don't know what Vine is.
Probably.
Yeah. Anyone not know what Vine is? Write in the
comments.
Anyways, we're going to look at two videos, and I haven't looked at these either, so we have to see guess which one between the two videos has more views.
All
cool?
Right.
Okay, here we go. First one. The goggles are hilarious.
I'm dead.
Okay, that was
that was good. That was good. Funny.
No! Oh! What?
That was terrifying.
My heart was racing for a second there.
I don't even
know. Oh my gosh.
Which one?
I know. I think my guess is going to be the car wash.
Yeah, I mean,
Why are they flipped?
I don't know.
Okay. I think it's gonna be the car wash video because that's what I think.
Yeah, I think the car wash video is definitely so crazy.
Yeah.
Number one, took more time, but number two, a lot more damage to the car.
I know, like they're gonna have to spend so much time actually cleaning their car now. The inside is like destroyed.
I don't even know. I think I'm gonna also go with number two.
Also,
number one was crazy. I thought he was about to like fall on the ground. That was terrifying.
Huge disclaimer, don't do either of these things.
No.
Highly disrecommend.
Dangerous and stupid.
Yeah. Anyways, the correct answer is...
Wow.
Oh, double.
That's not even like that much for TikTok. Like that is a lot, but like TikTok, you can
go viral. I've literally never had 750,000 of anything.
I understand, but
maybe like, grains of rice in my
life. That's really funny, so crazy. Like you would expect that there'd be more.
Right. That's not worth it.
No.
Right? Ruining your car is not worth 750,000.
That's crazy.
Maybe dollars.
They had
but
fun though.
It might be worth 750,000.
Well, yeah, because they could just get a new car then. Crazy.
Next one?
Yes.
We're off to a good start. Even though we both got that wrong. Men in Black. Classic.
Wipe it down. Wipe.
And you forgot. I don't remember.
I like that challenge.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Oh, I mean, Will Smith is famous, but this other one I've seen, and I've seen it not even on TikTok.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I feel like number one.
I'm going to go with Will.
Okay. It's because funny.
Will
That's
Smith is like,
iconic.
He's top echelon of celebrities.
Yeah, that's true.
Right?
Yeah.
Does he have a TikTok?
Yeah, he has a TikTok. He has a YouTube channel too. Very cool.
Oh. The correct answer is?
Ooh,
this is a lot of views both ways. Okay, Will Smith.
Understandable though. Yeah. His celebrity status really helps him.
Rate it 1 out of 10. How good are the Men in Black movies?
They're pretty good. I think the first one's the best, obviously.
How many are there?
I think there's two or three.
I don't know. I really like those movies.
I thought it was funny.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Good job, Will. I was actually hoping that the male woman was gonna do the dance.
Oh my gosh, I know, that would be really funny.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, let's go. Next one.
You know I like my chicken fried. Oh. Sweet tea and some waffle fries.
Okay.
Chick-fil-A sauce on the side.
Yes.
Okay.
And a little ketchup.
Wow, I feel insecure now.
That, but it's cool. I would say one because I just love their voices. I love Chick-fil-A. I love that song, the original song, Chicken Fried. That was the first country song I liked.
Oh, really? Interesting.
So maybe that's why I'm being a little more biased for it. Other one's cute. Like, I don't know.
I'm going to go with number two. Because you went with number one, okay. Mostly. But also, Micah loves Frozen. And
it's cute.
I like to think like babies get a lot of views.
They do. They really do.
That's tough. Like, I mean, Chick-fil-A gets a lot of views though. Dang.
And some good singing.
I know. We were filming this on a Sunday.
So the amount of times that I've been like, oh yeah, I'm gonna get Chick-fil-A tomorrow. And then it's Sunday. Missed my opportunity. So sad.
I want Chick-fil-A so bad right now. The correct answer is Barely. Oh, I'm honestly a little bit sad to know that, you know, Killer Harms don't get that many views. But
they can.
Frozen is frozen.
You can't compete.
Yeah. Next one.
Get my happy guy. Oh, just a happy
guy. All the leaves are gone.
Oh, just a look at that.
I like it, but not a lot. Was that Despicable Me?
Yeah.
Oh.
That is Despicable Me. That's funny. Okay, I'm gonna go with the dog because look at the little. My little happy guy. So cute.
Sorry, what was that?
I can't sing Ryan. No, I get it.
This is tough because, like, everybody loves dogs and everybody loves Christmas.
True.
So this is.
Also, that sound bite is, like, really funny. And, like, a lot of people like it.
Yeah.
But the little happy dog. Happy dog.
That dog is just so boopable.
I think I'm going to cry. The dog is really cute.
You want to watch it again?
Yeah, can't we? Okay.
One time, so Hannah can cry.
Happy guy. Oh, just a happy guy. Oh, just a look at that.
Happy dog.
You can tell that's
he's like enjoying
That's an
much.
Old pup too.
I know. Yeah. It's so sad.
Oh my gosh, she's crying.
No, okay.
This is where we did the zoom on Hannah's face.
No.
And the correct answer is.
You didn't hit the button.
Well, it's not even close. It's not even close. The dog has 10 times
That's
more views.
That's right, because he's so cute. Yeah. He's so happy and he's...
Yeah. Sorry,
so
Chris.
So cute. Yeah, Kris Kringle.
Gosh. Man.
Dang.
Is it Christmas yet?
Oh, honestly, if you told me it was, I'd still think it's
what
like
is time?
February.
What is time? Okay, what okay. We'll time? Do we'll do a couple more.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Oh!
That's so cute!
The little sound effects. You're the...
Holding the face.
I know.
Holding.
Oh, it's so aggressive.
There's so many of them.
You know what? How many? I saw it's one, four, five. Two, three, four, five. I saw another one, six, pop it said.
Wow.
Wait, also, really the cute. Eye contact is like really intense.
That was really cute.
Oh, two cats? Cat versus cat. I'm out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen
for myself a cup of ambition. Yawn and stretch and try to come to life. So cute.
Wait, with the music.
Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets, the traffic starts chopping with folks like me on the job.
Mow.
It's a deep voice cat.
Momo.
I mean, the kittens
are really cute.
They have a little high-pitched one. They're like, yeah. But that one, that's adult male.
Mo. Have you ever seen that video of that cat and he's like, no, and it's so deep and you're like, what? That was like old. Oh gosh.
I'm gonna go kittens.
I know, they're so cute.
The baby versions of everything.
I know, are so much cuter. Yeah. I'll go two because I just feel like
the adult cat.
Yeah, the adult cat. Because
this
is kind of funny.
This is a better video.
Yeah, this is cute though. Yeah. I would watch that one.
What got me with the kittens one was obviously all the noises. Yeah. But if you listen, even when the cat licked its lips, you could still hear a little.
This is not ASMR. Some ASMR stuff going on. Man.
Okay, and the correct answer is kittens.
Oh, by so much.
By so
this
much.
This didn't even get as many views as that that water, the guys in the...
The Jeep?
The guys in the Jeep. Yeah, the guys in the Jeep had 750.
Yeah, well...
That's crazy sad.
That cat's driving a Subaru, so that's probably why.
That's probably why. Just not as cool
okay,
as a Jeep.
We'll do last one.
Okay.
This is a lot, but if we need to cut some out, we can do that.
Okay.
Okay, and that, last one.
I love videos like this.
Yo, get it! That's a dream.
Dope. That was beautiful.
It was.
And that's why we always practice in the track first.
Okay. Okay. He's like flying. Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh. Oh, and he landed it.
Okay. Before you answer.
Okay.
Which one of these two things do you wish you could do?
The first one.
Yeah, for sure.
I just would do it all the time. Well,
He's getting barreled.
Yeah, oh, he's getting barreled.
He's getting shacked. He's getting... I don't sorry.
Pitted.
Yeah, I know that one.
Actually, okay, I would love... I feel like it's more realistic that I could do number one. Number two, I get, like, really freaked out when I'm on trampolines. I'm gonna, like, break my back. So I'm like,
you know who might be
flip.
Able to do this?
Who?
Chris Robbins.
Oh, of course, I'm sure.
Well, do you know his
He
past?
Did, what's it called?
Yeah.
What is that?
He did, Slam Ball.
Slam Ball.
Sorry, Chris, if I'm putting you out there and you didn't want this, but students, after this video, go YouTube search.
Search.
Chris Robbins Slam Ball.
All right, here comes the defending slam champion.
Oh, stretch. Oh, you gotta be kidding me. Ends up with the El Rolo lateral position. His body literally did a 360 on the rim after the forward roll onto the back. Watch this. Goes out, stretches out, stalls it out, goes up. Now watch the body rotation right there.
Oh,
the tortellini gets all corked up right there.
Slam ball is the greatest sport of all time, and your boy, Pastor Elder Chris Robbins, was a star in this professional sport.
Yeah, he's a professional athlete.
Yeah, it's true. All right, the correct answer.
One is more aesthetic, so I think that people.
Yeah,
will like
I'm
it
gonna
more.
Do that one too.
Two, though, was really cool. It's impressive.
I think it's the barrel. Oh my gosh!
By so much more.
You're not even close.
That's insane.
Well, I want to know the posted date.
Yeah.
Like, how old are these videos, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Like, was this uploaded 2 minutes ago?
And exactly. Then that one was uploaded
5 years ago.
TikTok is not 5 years old, but anyways. That was fun. Thanks for playing TikTok Tussle. Hope you guys enjoyed it. We're going to transition to one of our next segments. We're going to toss it over to our boy, Alec. One of our leaders, he's going to give you guys this week's quarantine tip.
Quarantine tip.
Wow.
I don't know. Just like, I don't know.
I felt like I was being threatened right there. Quarantine tip.
Hi, I'm Alec, and today I'm going to show you how to tie a Japanese square lash. Just like this. Hit him with the zoom in, the shameless YOCF plug. Perfect. Now we'll start. Take a loop of rope and slide it under the bottom stick of a cross pair. Then take both strings and wrap them over the top stick. Then under the bottom stick clockwise, and finally wrap them back over the top stick. You should see two wraps on the right, one wrap on the left, and a diagonal down the middle. Then repeat the same process. Wrap under, over, and back under again. You should now have two wraps on the right, three on the left, with the same middle diagonal. Then separate the strings and pass the top string back over the bottom stick. Then take the bottom string and pass it over to make an X with the middle diagonal. Title screen. Almost there. Pass the strings across each other and then under the top stick to the other side. Repeat the process. And finally, tie a square knot. Remember, these are left over right, tie, and then right over left, and pull it tight. Then cut the tag ends off, and boom, you got yourself a Japanese square latch. Now, why'd I teach you how to tie this weird knot? Well, you can make some cool stuff, like this trellis I made for my climbing plant. You can even use this knot to make shelter in a survival situation, or a tent on the beach. Try it out.
Woo!
All right, that was fun.
Quite the quarantine tip there.
The tips are just so helpful for my everyday quarantine.
Yeah, what was your favorite part about Alex's tip there?
Just the wisdom he gives us in the quarantine tip.
Yeah.
It's so good.
I actually think my entire quarantine time is going to be completely revolutionized now.
1,000%. My life will never be the same.
My quarantine. I don't know about my life.
No.
It's going pretty far.
But you want to know who also is a big, big life-changing person?
I don't know if you know. I'm looking for something.
Oh, what are you looking for?
Is it
over there? Oh, is it? Where's Ron?
Oh my gosh.
We don't know.
I don't know.
But you guys can help us find out. So where is Ron? Go.
Hello and welcome to another Where's Ron video. Today, there's a lot of concrete. You know, one little fact about concrete is there's actually several ingredients to concrete: rocks, sand, cement, and water. All right. Probably didn't know I had a degree in construction technology, but that's just the way it is. Today, there's a lot of concrete. And I'm out here just maybe get an idea of where I'm at. Most of you have probably been here. So maybe not in this exact spot, but as you see more, my fans are yelling at me. All right, any ideas yet? Doesn't look like it, but we'll give you some more hints. This is a very good hint. All right, and you guys now have probably noticed. Correct, I am in Manhattan Beach at the pier with everything around.
Well done, guys, we did it. He was once lost, but now
he's found.
He is found.
We got him.
Ronald, thank you for that. I love that. It's like I said that, you know, life groups and small groups after are my favorite part, but that was I'm realizing now that's a lie.
Yeah.
Where's Ron is my favorite part of these episodes. We're going to transition to our next part, and Hannah is going to sit down with one of our pastor elders, and they're going to really take one for the team here.
You guys will see.
This is a very tasty interview.
Just know that I do what I do because I love you guys, just letting you know.
It's true. She hates herself in these moments because she loves you. Take it away, Hannah.
Hi guys, we're here with Pastor Carlos today, and we are going to be playing a game and doing our interview. How are you doing?
Doing great.
Good. Yeah. So the game that we're going to be playing today is called Can Roulette. So I'll explain it. I already explained it to Pastor Carlos earlier, but we have tons of cans that we don't know what's in these. Both of us don't. We each have to choose one, and then we have to take one bite out of it. One bite. So, do you want to go first? Do you want me to go first?
Ladies first.
Okay. So while I'm doing this, let's ask our first question. How did you find yourself at YOCF? Or OCF, not
OCF. Oh, well, that's sort of a positive and negative. We were just part of a church that had become sort of unhealthy. Mm-hmm. And we did everything we could to try to, you know, make things better, but things weren't getting better. So My kids were really at an age where if we were going to switch churches, I needed to find a healthy church for them and give them enough time to make new friends. Mm-hmm. And so we started searching around, and we found OCF and been here ever since.
Yeah. Wonderful. So, first one, he was nervous thinking that I knew what these were, but I definitely didn't because this is fish. I would have not chosen this. It's so bad, guys. It's, ooh. Okay, one bite.
I'll pre-prank.
Oh, God. Mm-mm. So gross. Oh my gosh. No. Really disgusting. You're lucky. Hopefully.
Wow. But now I feel pressure to actually chew it and swallow it.
Well, now
you're strong, girl.
Thank you.
Props.
All right. Do you want to pick a can?
Sure. I'm going to go for the small one here.
Okay. All right. What does your job entail here at OCF? So the kid's like, no.
Okay, yeah. A big part of my job here is mission. And so there's kind of three ways to think about mission. You want to think about mission sort of in the way that Jesus described it to the disciples, mm-hmm. in the sense of you're going to go to Jerusalem, Judea, and the uttermost parts of the earth, yeah. with the gospel. And so that means missionaries abroad in other countries, mm-hmm. and that means doing mission work in areas nearby that are different from our area. Like it would be sort of the Judea, the Samarias, areas that are ministering to folks that perhaps in the inner city where things are culturally different, mm-hmm. but figuring out how we can minister there. And then of course in Jerusalem would mean ministering to folks here in El Segundo, reaching out and being involved that way. So that's a big part of my job here, is thinking about how we're doing as a church mission-wise.
Awesome. Cool. All right, crack that one open. Let's see what's in there.
Are you sure you don't want to ask me another question?
No. I would love to see what you're about to have a bite of. Also, don't feel pressured. You can spit it out.
I can spit it out. Oh, thank you.
I'll be nice. I'll be easy on him.
This doesn't smell good.
Oh, no. What is that?
Oh, my gosh.
Both of these do not smell good, guys. Disgusting. All right.
So don't...
Maybe don't smell it before you.
Yeah,
you're right.
I should probably pinch my nose.
Oh gosh. Oh, why is the
what
lip
is that?
Cloudy?
Who eats this? They're like. It's like teeth or something with.
Not teeth. I'll tell you after you take a bite. I know.
They
what
look
it is.
Like they look like small little bugs, or no. clams or something like. What are those kind of things that on along the sand? Gosh. Sand crabs? They look
sand?
Like.
Okay, you just gotta
I'll tell you this
part.
Much. It smells. My daughter's name is Hannah. It reminds me of the diapers I used to change on Hannah when she was little.
You guys heard it here first.
Is it right if I just have one?
Yeah, you can have just one. That's okay. I'm so sorry. Wow, It really is smelly up in here, guys. Good job. That was clams. You were right.
Oh, clams. Okay.
Yeah. But in that liquid, I did not think that that's like what it could be.
Mm.
Dang.
Ooh.
Gosh. Well, way to do that.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so you work at a church. Did you always see yourself working in ministry, or how did you feel like you found yourself in the position now?
That's a great question. I think I started sort of serving when I was maybe 18 or 20. And I was working with kids, and they were a lot of fun because, hey, you know, the lessons were short, and we spent most of the time playing ball out in the parking lot of church.
Yeah.
And so, since the church, most of the kids who came from sort of a inner city area, I drove a bus, and that was pretty crazy. I don't have the courage to do that anymore because I would drive this big bus down these really tight streets and pick up kids. And it was just a lot of fun, you know. It was every night we ended up sweaty and dirty.
So fun.
But so much fun, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so much fun.
That's awesome. Cool. All right, I'll pick one now. I'm so nervous. I honestly have no clue what these are. Okay. So, since you have gone on mission trips, right?
Yeah.
Do you have any fun stories of, like, something that's been, like, really funny that's happened on a mission trip?
Well, the first one that comes to mind, it was one of our, we've done three trips to France, and I'm not sure if it'll be funny maybe for high schoolers, but it was certainly funny for me. We had one of the guys who went with us, some of us had tried practicing French. Mm-hmm. I sort of gave up on trying to, before the trip. And so the first night in France, we went into a Burger King. And, of course, couldn't read the signs. And the first guy up front, the lady was getting really irritated with him because he was saying the words and adding sort of an accent and thinking that made it French.
Oh.
So... I could see her face frustrated, and then I finally caught ear of what he was saying, and this is and what he was saying to her was, "I want a Caesar salad." She's like, that's not French, bro. So finally, the missionary that was with us came, walked up, and saved him because the lady was getting so frustrated. So,
yeah. That's a good one.
Yeah, it was a good one.
That's funny. Wow. Oh gosh, that's good. Okay, so.
Oh, that looks like kind of like sauerkraut.
It just might be.
Oh, that's not too bad.
I don't know.
I'm not a big sauerkraut fan myself. But.
Oh, well, then lucky you did not get this one.
Yeah. It's probably better with a sausage.
Oh, gosh. That tastes literally like the can. Ugh. Not a fan. Not a fan. Well,
just looking at it makes me want to get
it wants to make you have one. Okay, you can pick out your next can.
All right, I'm gonna go for this big one here.
Oh man.
I might regret this. Might be a
you may
big,
or may
big
not.
Old can of dog food or something.
That'd be crazy.
All right. Okay.
So why do you believe missions and outreach is important, like from a personal standpoint?
You know, I'll give you two reasons.
Okay.
Oh, praise God. I think I scored. This looks like pineapples.
Wow.
Yeah, baby.
Lucky.
Merry Christmas.
What a great thing to wash down those plants.
Yeah,
with.
Yeah, yeah. The first reason is you know, if we don't reach out to people, you won't at some point you sort of lose sight of the fact that you wouldn't know about Christ had somebody not tried to share him with you.
Yeah, so true.
You know, it's like, wow, somebody took the risk, went through the embarrassment, through the awkwardness, you know, cared enough to talk to me. And because my family, I wasn't raised in church. And so now I look back, in fact, think of it, and this is funny. I just told you how I used to drive the bus.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I came to church. There was a bus that used to come around and
wow,
pick up kids.
That's so cool.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm so just thinking about back. That connection right now. I was like, wow, I don't know who that bus driver was, but I'm really grateful for his service to
yeah.
pick up kids for church in a weird neighborhood
yeah.
and then bring them back to church. And so that's how me and three of my brothers came to Christ.
Wow, that's really sweet.
Yeah, yeah. So it's such a simple, faithful service.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the other reason I think that's important is I feel like since a major goal in my life is to become like Christ, it's hard for me to really do that unless I care enough to act.
Mm.
And so if my faith doesn't have a venue to care enough to act in the best interest of
yeah.
another person, then how do I know it's real?
Yeah.
And so I think trying to share your faith with people makes you think about what you believe, makes you really practice what you believe, and to care about people, just to care about people. People who will disagree with you,
mm-hmm.
even.
Yeah, for
so,
sure.
So, I'm going to have a...
Get in there.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I think, you know what? This looks so good, I'm going to have two.
Oh, okay. Well, you're more than welcome to eat the rest of that later. You might need another...
Delicious.
...little wash down.
You're right.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think a quote that I heard from somebody once was like, if you truly do believe, like as a Christian, mm-hmm. that you know something that is so valuable, why wouldn't you share it? Like if you think
yeah.
that you have the best news on earth, then why wouldn't you share it with other people?
That's right.
So what has been one of the most impactful missions that you've gotten to be a part of or mission trips that you've gotten to do, whether that's partnering with a local organization somewhere or something.
I think the strategy that we used in France, it was actually even, we were better at it, so I think the second trip was better for a couple reasons. What we did in France was we put on an English-speaking camp. The town that we were in was where three countries sort of merged, Switzerland, Germany, and France.
Yeah.
And I mean like 20 minutes from the border.
Wow, that's crazy.
You can walk 20 minutes and you can cross into France or you go down a different street and you cross into Switzerland.
So cool.
Yeah, it was very cool. And so English is in high demand because lots of the employers around there do international business, and English is very universal. And so it's a strong demand that if you want to move into certain businesses to be able to speak English. Mm-hmm. And so we offered this English speaking camp for a week.
Wow.
And so it was what was sort of cool, I think, for the French kids is like, oh, wow, these are real Americans that are coming over here, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And to them, like, you know, they think all of us know, you know, Hollywood actresses and whatever.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Totally.
And so they're totally in the pop culture. So I showed up a lot with my, you know, surf shirts or California shirts. And so, yeah, it was cool. And so one of the things we taught the kids was baseball.
Oh, so fun.
Oh, yeah. And they'd never played baseball, but they were so funny. Yeah, within a few days, they were reminding me of the rules. They were pretty competitive, but it was great because what we did with these high schoolers was we journaled every day, and so every day I would write in a journal to one of the students little personal things about myself and about my journey, and then ask them questions, and they would journal back. And so by the end of the week, you were able to share more personal things about your faith and who you are and why you're there.
Wow, that's so sweet.
So there was this sort of progression. So it was really powerful to sort of hear the kids open up more and more as the week went on.
Yeah, that's so sweet.
Yeah.
I love that. I'm gonna make a choice. So what do you think that, like, during COVID season right now, kids are not able to, like, really get out and share their faith in ways of, like, going on the streets, maybe at school, in different ways like that. So what are some ways that you think that might be good for students to try and also focus on outreach during this season?
Yeah, I think There's an acronym that I use that we use with our small group, and we even do it as in our mission team. It's called BLESS,
mm-hmm.
It was created by a church who really wanted to reach out to their surrounding area, and I'll go through it quickly. The B stands for begin with prayer, so I have a list of people that I'm praying for,
mm-hmm.
and one of the ways that list has impacted me is now when I go out, because some of them include neighbors. I've now found myself, and I'm going out to my car, and I'll see my neighbor, maybe perhaps by his car, and I'll remind myself, well, I've been praying for this person, and then realize, I don't know that I remember his name.
Mm.
And then I'll walk over and talk to him, get his name. So that's just an example of praying for people, whether it's family or friends, really sort of keeps your mind sensitive to them, rather than just simply you accomplishing what you want to accomplish. So B was begin with prayer. L was to listen to people.
Mm-hmm.
So I've started in sort of these short conversations with neighbors. I've started to listen to some of the things about their lives. Like one guy, I didn't realize he was always riding his bike over to his mother's house to take care of her. I didn't realize that was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get to know them, and so the conversations become a little more deeper. So the next letter is E, which means eat. And basically just means be able to find moments where perhaps, you know, you can be more involved with people. And eating is something that's pretty powerful, because if you can get the person to sit down and enjoy a meal with you, you know, you've connected with them.
Totally.
S stands for serve. Sometimes you can, as you get to know your neighbors, you find out they have a need. You know, or if they're going on vacation, then you offer to take care of their animal or something.
Mm-hmm.
So you just, because you're listening, because you're talking, because you're engaging, now you hear about some needs that you can perhaps care for them. And the last one is share.
Wow.
You know, find an opportunity to share your faith. And so we've been doing that, and it's been wonderful to hear the stories with our small group and the missions team of just, because if you think about it, most of us have been around more of our neighbors than we have our church family for the last 4 months.
Yeah.
Right? And so it's like, well, what's been the plan? Well, the plan is simply to try to stay connected to church as much as possible. And it's like, Well, maybe since the opportunity we find ourselves in right now isn't all about church, maybe it can direct our attention to our neighbors.
Yeah, that's perfect.
So yeah, it's a BLESS is a great acronym.
That's a great acronym.
Sorry for the long answer.
No, that was great. That was perfect. I'm going to take a bite of, I don't really know but, what this is. Oh,
oh yeah.
Oh, no.
You know what?
It's okay.
I think I might have it.
We'll clean it up later. No,
that's
it's okay.
My mask.
We'll clean it up later. We'll clean it
Here's
up later.
Here's the tissue.
Oh, thank you. Thank
You're
you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh. It looks like dog food.
I don't know.
Or it could be refried beans.
That is true. I didn't realize that there was going to be. It's like oily, though.
Mm.
Interesting.
Better you than me.
I should not have smelled it. Oh, no. I'm gonna have to figure this out. Sorry, guys. That was probably gross. That was just. Oh, no. Oh.
I guess it's not refried beans.
It was beans, but it just tasted funky. Oh, no. Maybe they were not great. I'm not sure. You wanna grab another can?
Oh, yeah.
Make your choice.
Come, Lord Jesus.
While you're opening up that can, we'll ask our last question. We ask everyone, what's your favorite scripture that is in the Bible that has just, like, really impacted you throughout your life?
Well, I got a couple. I think one that comes to mind is 2 Timothy 4:12. And I think... the reason this passage was powerful to me because I came from a broken home. My dad died when I was about 10. And so when after I'd gotten saved and went into my teenage years, there was a gap there where I wasn't really going to church. But when I came back and I started walking with the Lord, I was even really, really desirous of following Christ and knowing Him. And then within a short few years, I found myself working with other young guys. And it's sort of a weird situation where, like, wow, bro, I'm only, like, you know, a mile ahead of you, but I can help pull you forward.
Yeah.
And so that passage is talking to Timothy, and it says, you know, don't let anybody look down on you because you're young.
Yeah.
You know, and then he says something really powerful. He says, you know, but you set an example for the believers in speech and life and love and faith and purity, you know, the way you act, the way you behave. And it was so powerful to me because it wasn't, hey, do you want people to take you serious? Hey, you want people to respect you? Behave. It was more than that. It was let your example live in such a way that your life is actually an example to others of how to do this. So it's not really to try to own your own props or gain your own respect. It was act in such a way as that it would be an example to those around you. And it was like, wow, I just sort of think about myself.
Yeah.
But it was great counsel for me because I at times struggled with the insecurities of everything I didn't have,
yeah.
everything I didn't accomplish,
yeah.
sort of the brokenness of my family. And I think in so many ways it was God sort of telling me, I need you to stop feeling sorry for yourself. This is not making anything better.
Yeah.
You know, I need you to sort of fixate yourself on everything that I've done for you, the future I have planned for you, and ask yourself what the right thing is to do in a particular situation, right?
Yeah.
Not whether or not somebody will admire you, respect you, and do it in such a way as that you would be an example to other people.
Mm.
That sort of otherness thinking about what it was just like blew my mind. It was like,
yeah.
Wow, okay, that's a God thing. I don't think that far outside the box.
Mm-hmm.
So that's always been a powerful passage for me. And it was a powerful passage when I would counsel a lot of young guys who came from broken homes too.
Yeah.
It was like, hey, bro, we need to stop feeling sorry for ourselves.
Yeah.
Because if we want to make a difference for our family in the future, then we need to own our stuff.
Yeah.
Amen.
Definitely.
All right.
That's some good wisdom.
I was hoping to, I should have got out of this, but I didn't.
Yeah, he tried.
This doesn't look too bad.
What do you think it is?
I don't know. It looks like honestly, I'm Cuban, so it looks like a plantain, but I know it's not. And, oh, why does, doesn't smell like a plantain either.
Chomp chomp.
Mmm.
Is it good? sounds so good. Mixed facial expressions. I
should have grabbed a smaller one.
Oh, you can spit it out if you want.
It's some sort of a potato or something.
Yeah, it's a potato. Okay, we won't open up these last ones, but thank you so much, Carlos, for joining us today. We had a great time, lots of wisdom
you
gave us.
Thank you.
Hopefully you won't go home and be sick after eating some of this
stuff that
you opened up today. But all right, guys, we will see you back at the desk. Bye.
Bye.
Welcome back. Hannah, where'd you go?
Did you,
What is this?
You need a little treat?
No.
A little hungry treat? We had two leftover cans, so, Ryan.
Yes? Can I help you, Anna?
Would you like to make a choice? Which one?
No, I don't want to.
Just try it. It'll be fine. Don't worry. I got you a spoon and everything.
Wait, did you really do
that? Yeah, I really did.
I don't know how to use a can opener, so I can't do it.
Well, you can choose one. One
all
or
right,
two.
All right, let's...
What will it be?
I'll take this one.
The one that's
are you gonna
more
eat that
liquidy?
One? It seems only fair if you're gonna make me eat one at the desk for you to also eat one at the desk.
Fine, I will.
Well, and I have a spoon and you don't, so you have to eat yours however you want to. Wait. Honestly, I was sitting in the room for that interview and the entire room smelled awful.
The clams really. Also, everything else was really gross, too.
It was all gross.
The beans I had to spit out, guys. They were
what
really
is
disgusting.
This?
I don't know. You have to just figure it out. Don't throw up, please. We have no trash cans near us. Mine is,
Have you seen that meme of the cat who's, like, coughing?
Yeah.
That's kind of what I'm looking... What do you have? Oh, my gosh. Okay.
I wish...
Okay, well, cheers. Actually,
oh wow,
I feel
mine.
It smells like it smells like sunscreen and feet.
And, I don't like the
and
feet part.
Coconut.
I don't like the feet part added in there. Everything else.
Actually, I really lucked out here. What do I have? Are these peaches?
No, just try it.
Yeah, these are delicious, right? All right, here we go. I got a good one. Oh, yeah. What is that?
Pears.
Oh, yeah. What did you get?
Coconut.
Is it bad?
Milk. But it's so
thick. Is coconut
milk? It coated my mouth. This is not what I want just by itself.
I'm sticking by the feet comment. It actually doesn't smell very good.
You should try it.
I appreciate the thought, but we're going to move on.
Okay.
I did what you asked me to do. I ate
Thank
the
you for being
I really
a
lucked out with the peaches there, though.
You really, really... They're pears.
Oh, yeah. Pears. Why do I keep saying peaches?
I don't know. You wanted peaches.
Yeah.
All right. But, yeah, thanks for being such a good team player.
Yeah.
We are
actually,
gonna...
thank you to Pastor Carlos.
Oh, yeah.
He was the real team player.
I know.
He ate some awful stuff.
Some
and
really
he didn't know
things.
That he was coming to do that. So
I know.
It was good.
Yeah. So good. So now we're going to be transitioning into a little bit more of a serious time. We're going to have our worship by our girl Pearl, and we are going to hear a little sermon from our guy Rye.
Girl Pearl.
Guy Rye. Take it away. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Because Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? 'Cause Jesus is calling. Oh,
glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise. To glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against. So yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy.
What's up, guys? It's your boy Ryan. Excited to be back here for the fifth parable in our series. If you guys have been with us, then you know we've been walking through different parables that are just essentially short stories that Jesus tells to convey some sort of spiritual lesson or principle. And we're going to look at another one today. But I wanted to tell you guys, as I was preparing and looking at the parable that we're going to look at today, I wanted to brag. Because this week was my anniversary with my wife. And it was definitely the weirdest anniversary we've ever had. So we went out to dinner, but if you guys have been out to dinner in this season, you know it's weird. You have to wear masks and everyone's distance, and we're sitting out in, you know, the parking lot. But it was good. You know, we did the most that we could, and you know, we promised each other that once things are back to normal, whatever that is, that we'll celebrate better and for reals. But the reason I even bring up my anniversary is because today we're going to look at the story of the parable of the wedding feast. So if you have your Bibles, then open it up to Luke chapter 14. We're going to look at verse 7 through verse 11. And we're going to check out this parable, the parable of the wedding feast. This is an interesting one because it only shows up in the book of Luke. Oftentimes, parables show up in all of the Gospels or some of the Gospels. This one in particular, you can only find in the book of Luke. So I'm going to read it for us real quick and give you a few thoughts and challenge us a little bit in the way that we're living, especially in light of COVID here. So I'll read it along. I'll read it and you can read along with me. This is what it says. The parable of the wedding feast. Now, he told a parable, Jesus told a parable to those who were invited when he noticed how they chose the places of honor, saying to them, when you are invited by someone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in a place of honor, lest someone more distinguished than you be invited by them. And he who invited you both will come and say to you, give your place to this person, and then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you're invited, go and sit in the lowest place, so that when the host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now, what is this talking about? I remember at our wedding, and lots of weddings do this, where there's a wedding party table. Where the bride and groom sit at the center, and like all of the groomsmen and the bridesmaids sit next to the bride and groom. And this table is kind of like an important table. It's a distinguished table. All the important people sit there. We didn't do like assigned seating at our wedding. The only people that we assigned seating for was our families, because we wanted them to be close, and we wanted to make sure that they had a good place to sit where they could see and be a part of the wedding. Everyone else was on their own. But at this time, often when people would, you know, host a party or have a wedding, for example, there was always this this table. And at the time, these tables of honor of the people who were invited would often be shaped in a U. Okay, so everyone would kind of sit on the outside, and the host would sit in the middle at the bottom of the U. If you can imagine, they would sit down here. And the places of honor were the seats directly next to the host, either to the right or to the left. And you kind of, the importance of the people kind of would get less and less important as you would go farther down the U. But they would still be invited. They would still get to sit at the table. So they were still important, but they were not seated in the place of honor. Kind of think like the Last Supper. You know how we always make fun of, like, why are there 13 people who are all sitting on one side of the table? This is why, because that's what was normal at the time. When you would sit at this distinguished table, everyone would sit on one side, kind of like a wedding party like we did. We would all sit on one side of the table so we could face everyone else and see. And the chairs directly next to me and Emily for our wedding were the most important people. The groom, not the groom, the maid of honor and the best man got to sit right next to us. So this story, let me break it down for you real quick. Basically, Jesus is saying, if you're invited to sit at this table, you shouldn't go sit next to the host, which again is the seat of honor, right? Because what happens if you're sitting in that seat and someone more important shows up to the party? The host is gonna have to look at you and be like, buddy, this seat is taken, and it's taken by somebody that's more important to you. So I'm gonna need you to move to the end of the table. And it's embarrassing for you, and you have to get up and grab your stuff and walk all the way to the end of the table. And we can avoid that whole situation if we have this thing that Jesus is advocating for, and it's humility. So if we're humble when we're invited to a situation like this, or when we're invited to sit at the table, what Jesus is saying is verse 10, but when you're invited, go and sit in the lowest place, farthest away from the seat of honor, farthest away from the host. This is what it says. So that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Now that's a good feeling, right? When you sit in one place that is, and there's space between you and the distinguished seats, and the host says, no, you don't belong at the bottom of the table. You belong next to me. So come, grab your stuff and move next to me. I want you to be seated right next to me at the in the distinguished seat. Not only do you get the honor of getting to be the distinguished guest, but you also have shown that you're humble in this situation by not assuming and being arrogant and claiming that seat off the bat. And this is not just a practical application for us. It's not just like, hey, every time you go to a party, it's better for you to sit in the other place because you'll feel good about yourself if you get invited up. No, this is Jesus explaining that this needs to be the posture of our heart in all situations. That when we view ourselves, we shouldn't view ourselves in a way where we think we're a distinguished and an honorable and important person. Instead, when we think of ourselves humbly, and when we think of ourselves, and when we think of others as more important than us, then not only will we get to put on display the humility and confidence that we have in humility, but we have the opportunity to be invited up by the host. And in our spiritual lives, the host is God. God will invite us from our lowest places and give us the ability to sit next to him in the distinguished seat. Now, this is such an incredible picture of what the gospel looks like. Now, why does Jesus even share this story? It's because he's trying to help us understand why it's important to be humble, why it's important for us to share humility. There's a verse back in Proverbs. I should have flipped there before. But Proverbs 25, verse 6, references this right here. It says, do not put yourself forward in the king's presence or stand in the place of the great. For it is better to be told, come up here, than to be put lower in the presence of nobles. This is not a foreign concept that Jesus is explaining to the people who are listening. He's not explaining this to us for the first time. There is great practical wisdom. We have the ultimate example of what verse 11 explains here. It says, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. What he's saying here is those who are prideful will be shamed and be sent to the back, and those who are humble will get invited to the front, right? And he who humbles himself will be exalted. If that's not one of the best explanations of who Jesus is and what he did on our behalf, then I don't know what it is. So what does that look like? How do we do that? This is something that is included in the Bible because this is a problem and a propensity of human nature since the beginning of time, right? Proverbs talks about it. Jesus is explaining this to the people who are listening 2,000 years ago. And today, we still struggle with these things. I'm gonna give an example and kind of date myself a little bit and show my age. But when I was a kid, there was this social media platform called MySpace. Maybe some of you guys have heard of it. But one of the elements of MySpace was you got to have this thing called a top eight, where you pick your eight best friends and those people get to be displayed on your web page. And it was a big deal because you were supposed to place them in order of importance from best to worst, and you could only include those eight. And I knew lots of people whose friendships were ruined because of MySpace top eight. This concept of humility and exalting ourselves and this pride that we have from being a distinguished person in the eyes of other people is something that we still struggle with every single day. So I have a couple challenges for you guys. What does this look like today? Maybe, I doubt many of you guys are gonna be going to a wedding, especially in this season. There are still weddings happening, but there are very few social gatherings or parties or places where you can go where there's a host. So what does this look like today? What does this look like in 2020, in the season of COVID? What does this look like to be a student in this time? And these are the things that I wrote down. If you have siblings, if you're anything like me and my siblings, then you always fought for the best seat in the car, right? Whether that was by the window or behind the driver, or maybe it's shotgun in the front. And we all play the game where the second you see that car, the first person to call shotgun gets to sit at the front. I remember one time when I was a kid, I was challenged with this idea of humility. And the speaker said to us, like, you know what? What if instead we showed our siblings what it's like to be humble when it comes to who sits where in the car? And so next time you approach the car, instead of shouting shotgun, shout backseat middle. And that was his thing. He's like, you know what? Let's get rid of shotgun. Let's just call out backseat middle. Because everybody knows the backseat and the middle seat is the worst seat in the car, right? It's not comfortable. Maybe your seatbelt's weird. You're squished in between people. But if that was the seat you were calling and giving up the better seats for your siblings, for your family, whoever's in the car with you, man, what a great picture of humility in that moment. So I want to hear you guys calling out backseat middle instead of shotgun next time. Maybe if you're having dinner or lunch or breakfast or whatever, maybe if you just waited to get your food last, right? I know whenever mealtime comes around, I'm hungry. So I'm like excited and ready to grab food. But one way we can show humility is to let others grab food before us. Very simple, very easy, very practical. The last one that I think is something that I struggle with a lot is I am not very patient when it comes to people texting me or calling me back. If I have sent somebody a text message, I expect a response pretty quickly. But I recognize and understand that part of humility and part of putting others first is recognizing that, hey, just because I send them a text doesn't mean that they're supposed to drop everything that they're doing in that moment to respond to me, right? This is something that I try and put in play all the time. I'm really bad at responding to text messages and emails and picking up my phone because I try to live this out. If I'm doing something that's important or if I'm with people face to face, especially if it's my family, those moments and interactions will always take precedence over whatever's happening on my phone. It's so easy and I have such a tendency to be glued to my phone, so I try really hard to live in the present with whoever I'm in the presence of. And so maybe try that. If somebody doesn't text you back right away, then maybe let that one slide. Or even if somebody texts you and there's somebody that you're sitting in front of, maybe you're eating a meal and your parents are sitting there or your siblings are sitting there. Try putting your phone away and responding to that after the meal and being present with those you're in the presence of. And so I want to read this last verse one more time, and I'll pray us out here. Luke chapter 14, the parable of the wedding feast, verse 11 says, "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, everyone who is prideful, everyone who is full of themselves, everyone who assumes the seat of honor, the Bible says, will be humbled. They'll be put to shame and be sent to the back of the table. On the flip side, he who humbles himself will be exalted. So I pray that we would be a group of students and a youth group who is characterized by humility. And because of that, we will be exalted and be invited up to sit at the right hand of God and of Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. We thank you for this time, and we thank you for this parable. God, we have such a tendency as human beings to put ourselves above others. So God, my prayer is that we would humble ourselves and thus be exalted in your name. God, would you protect us from any opportunities or any tendencies for us to be selfish or any opportunities for us to be exalting ourselves. God, protect us from the humiliation that will come when we act that way. Instead, replace that with humility, replace that with others above ourselves. We love you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys.
All right, thanks so much, Ryan, for sharing all of your wisdom with that parable and Pearl leading us in some worship. I really just really can't wait for the day where we can all be together hear a message and worship together in person.
Maybe when we're all back together, we should throw a big party, and the party theme will be wedding reception. I love weddings.
Same. Everyone the best. Could wear fun wedding
stuff. We'll have a dance floor.
Let's go.
We'll have music.
Tear it up.
We'll have food. We can do toasts. That would be awesome. Everybody makes speeches and stuff. Yeah, that would be awesome.
Toast with toast.
Yeah.
That'd be good.
Yeah, well, guys, thank you for stopping by. Make sure to check the comment section for the link to our Zoom.
Yes.
And join us for our small groups. This is such an important time, especially in the midst of isolation and quarantine, for us to be connecting with one another. This has been episode 5. I'm Ryan.
I'm Hannah.
Love you guys.
Bye.